And let us bring out our contestants. I can't let anybody see here.
We'll do the order. We'll do it.
Here we are.
We're
good? Sorry? Let's do it from your, from stage right to stage left. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the creators of the Thrilling Adventure Hour, you will hear it and see it on Thursday night. Mr. Ben Acker is right here. Ben, come out. Roboticist, so brilliant, he's from Mythbusters, he actually created a robot imitation of himself and staved home. Granny Mahara is here. Granny. Right there, another veteran of JoCo 1, your favorite ukuleleist and mine, Ms. Molly Lewis is here. Our next contestant how I should describe her, and she simply said, a genius. Ladies and gentlemen, genius Robin Goldwasser, a sea monkey. There she is. Who's next? The dean of the dark arts of gaming, the most successful nerd in the world, Mr. Will Wheaton. And you know him, you've heard him, you love him, Mr. Hank Green is rounding up your table. So, like I said, we have invented a game, which we're calling This American Life. Unlike the quiz I did the first year, these questions have answers. What we are going to do is I am going to ask a question and then ask two of your contestants to answer them. So, perhaps the first one, Ben and Hank, will answer. We'll work in, then we'll start again. They might know the right answer. In which case, if the first person knows the right answer, the second person is shit out of luck. Because he or she has to give a different answer. All right? Then the other four contestants will vote. Right? You are allowed to lobby. You are allowed to inquire. You are allowed to cast aspersions upon the other answerer.
Excellent.
And as much in the same way games like Balderdash or Dixit, you get a point if you get the answer right. As the answer, you get a point if another person chooses you as having given the right answer. You get a point if somebody chooses you, even though your answer was wrong. And of course, if you are not an answerer of the question, you get a point for correctly choosing the right answer. Okay? If neither answerer knows the real answer, then nobody gets those points. I know that was all confusing.
Who's writing down these points? It's very complicated. There's a lot of...
Good question. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Scarface himself. Scarface. We'll keep you score. Drew, thank you. I've always wanted my own deformed minion. I never expected him to be so good looking. So those are the breaks. All right, is everybody ready to play?
Yeah.
Ready.
All right, here we go. And remember, you are allowed to kibitz. Our first category in this inaugural edition of This American Life. I am enjoying that, by the way. Is current events. Current events. Again, we'll start at the ends. So this will be Hank and Ben answering the question. Ben, I turn to you. The question is, according to a leading trade organization, this was in the news last week, America is facing a severe shortage of what? Ben, what is America facing a severe shortage of?
Wheat.
Wheat. Wheat. We're having a wheat shortage.
Yeah. Right. World wheat shortage.
Right. You know why? Well, we're all gluten-free now. It shouldn't matter. All right. So the answer from Ben is wheat. The answer from Hank is?
Indium. Wheat is a hilariously bad answer.
Indium?
Indium. Yes, the element indium.
Hold on. There's someone else in the millennium selenium. And I did it right here. What do you use indium for?
It's used in thin film solar panels and LCD TVs.
All right. So, the answer... Wheat. So, ladies and gentlemen, we address ourselves to the other four contestants. The answer...
Like bread, wheat.
Yes. How many uses of wheat?
That's the main one, but there's also...
Beer.
Beer.
Beer. Beer. Emergency. What? Emergency?
All right.
I mean, did anybody go to, like, food at all today? Were you surprised by the lack of wheat products?
I was concerned by the presence of wheat and its byproducts on the ship, actually.
Wheat and wheat byproducts. Competing podcasts, keep your mouth shut. All right. So, we have wheat from Ben. We have...
a made-up element.
India,
not a made-up element. Use this article.
I have a question for Ben.
If you guys, please.
Ben, do you know the name of the trade organization that made the announcement?
Pass.
Pass organization.
Pass. I think he's passing. He doesn't know.
Thank you.
So if a wheat shortage or an Indian shortage, please, as you guys know, you have sheets in front of you. You're going to pick the people. You're going to pick the person that you think is the right answer. In this case, obviously, your choices are Ben or Hank. Please sheaf through your papers, find them.
Quizmaster Sagal, if you believe that both of these people are full of shit, what? How would you present that?
This is not my problem. Well, you know, this is in beta, man. Give me a break, okay? All right. So, have everybody chosen?
So, I'm ready.
Okay. All right, ready? And who are you choosing? You're choosing Hank. Hank.
I don't think either of them are correct, well, so what am I going to do?
You are apportioning points, so you have to pick somebody.
Is this a competition?
You have to pick somebody. So yeah. Hank, we have three for Hank, and what do you have to pick?
I'm just gonna pick
or one for Ben.
It's just as bullshit as
Ben. All right, so America is facing a severe shortage of clowns. The clowns of America, this is the trade group, says that fewer and fewer young people are becoming clowns because most people today, like yourselves, want to go into the arts, business, or tech rather than a career embodying their own childhood nightmares. So,
we're closest without going over.
So, according to the scoring, we have 3 points for Hank and 1 point for Ben. Very good. All right. Next question. Question goes to Grant and to Will. In 2009, a survey in the UK revealed that more than half of all Britons had been injured by what?
Curling.
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 They're like that over there. Actually, I was speaking, Mike, who helped me design the game, actually broke his arm curling. So that can happen. So yeah. Curling here.
2009, right?
2009
curling.
Will's answer. In 2009, a survey revealed that more than half of all Britons had been injured by what?
Cane accidents.
What accidents?
Cane-related accidents.
Canes, like...
Yes.
You mean like walking with a
like
cane?
Like a walking cane. Okay. It sticks in cobbles and occasionally then breaks off, revealing a sword within.
Yes. Always embarrassing in certain social situations. So the answer is from Grant.
Curling.
Curling. Said with confidence. Now, the answer from Will is cane accidents. Do we have any colloquy, as they say? Anybody want to inquire after this?
I just want to observe for a moment that curling, being a Canadian sport, seems an odd thing that would damage half of Britons.
It is an international, it's an Olympic sport.
And they also could have injured themselves, like, curling their hair. We didn't specify.
That's true.
You mean in the 2009 imaginary of the Olympics?
They are practicing. These are people who hurt themselves, so they're not actually Olympic athletes.
Half of all Britons.
Grant, I think you probably should go with Molly's interpretation
of
curling.
I'm also here to tell you, yeah, curling irons get hot. You can burn yourself.
Yeah, and
half of all Britons are curling.
All right, maybe so I'm going to bring this to a close so that you've heard the choices. Grant's answer is curling. Will's answer is cane accidents. Please make your choice. And you were stuck with these two guys, I'm sorry. If you are sorry about that, reconsider all the choices you made in your life to bring you to this point. Have we all made our choices? All right, please reveal your choices. We have...
Molly.
You can't vote for Molly.
You voted for Grant? Judas!
Molly voted for Grant.
Was a great answer. Grants.
We have Grant. You can't vote for Molly. I know, we all like Molly, she's very cute, but you cannot vote for her in this context.
This is a competition?
Adores, am I right? So you have to pick somebody. You have to pick somebody because you're apportioning points.
Like real points? Why can't I pick Molly?
They're notional points. Yes.
You got it.
All right, so pick somebody. You have to pick Grant or Will, and I'll just point out, because you didn't do it right, now you know that Grant has the other three votes, so you can take some pity.
That's right, I forgot.
Yeah, that's me. That's me. Will, all right.
Flip the sympathy card, me.
Okay. Once again, we have a 3-1, so it's 3 points for three choices for Grant, one choice for Will. The answer is, what?
May I add adorbs, am I right, to my list of quotes from people?
Adorbs, am I right?
You and
adorbs,
Steve
Fry, yes, by all means.
I would like to take this opportunity to pass.
All right. In 2009, a survey revealed that more than half of all Britons have been, adults have been injured while eating during a tea or coffee break, with at least 500 landing themselves in hospital. The custard cream biscuit was found to be the worst offender. It beat, blah, blah, blah. This was calculated by the Biscuit Injury Threat Evaluation. Hidden dangers included flying fragments and being hurt while dunking in scalding tea, through to the more strange, such as people poking themselves in the eye with a biscuit or falling off a chair reaching for a tin. One man, again from the Daily Telegraph, one man even ended up stuck in wet concrete after wading in to pick up a stray biscuit.
All right. I somehow don't think this is the biscuit's fault, though.
No. I think we know why Britain doesn't have a space program.
I am going to make a flying rule change, because clearly you guys are not as well as informed as I hoped. I am now going to apportion 2 points if you, as the answerer, get the right answer. So there's more incentive to get it correct. Here we go. So now you get 2 points, and of course we're down to Molly and Robin. The Stuxnet virus was designed by forces unknown to attack Iranian nuclear science in 2010. You remember, because you're all nerds, that it disabled their centrifuges. We don't know where it came from. In 2012, another virus struck the Iranian nuclear scientists, and this time it did what? This time I'll turn to my left. Robin, what is your answer?
Hangover.
What?
Hangover.
Are you saying it gave them a hangover?
I'm saying I have a hangover.
That's not a credible answer in this case.
What now?
This is 2012. This is after the Stuxnet virus. By the way, I'm just curious, because I'm guessing that does anybody in this room know? Don't say so. Yes, he knows. Okay, go ahead. Anybody else? I'm right there. Okay. Robin, we await you.
Oh, I'm sorry. They turned off all their traffic lights.
Turned off all their traffic lights. That's Robin's suggestion.
Yeah.
Molly.
It made all their eyelashes and eyebrows fall out.
That would be terrifying.
A computer virus?
Yeah. Computer virus.
That's virulent.
All right.
So guys,
so just to clarify, from Robin, we have it turn off their traffic lights. From Molly, we have their eyebrows and eyelashes.
I like Molly's, and I might have to vote for Molly.
You can. I understand. So we're all choosing. Does anybody have any questions for the answerers?
That's good.
All right. What do we have? So ready to vote? All right, vote please. Hank, everybody votes. Robin, Molly, and Robin. This virus that came after the Stuxnet virus, this is 2012, turned on their computers at 3 a.m. and played Thunderstruck by AC/DC. Yeah! So again, no points for going to an answer, but I think it was 3 points for Robin and one for Molly. Okay, you're cool with that. All right, let's start again, and this time I'm bad at math, but I think if we do Hank and Molly, we will have different setups. So Hank and Molly are the answerers this time. We are a new category. It is Geekery. Oh. Geekery. Specifically comic books. Oh. In his infamous 1954 book, Seduction of the Innocent, which warned Americans to the dangers posed by comic books and led to a congressional hearings, by the way, Dr. Frederick Wortham said that Batman comics, in particular, posed a danger to youth. What danger were Batman comics posing to the youth? And this time I think we'll let Hank go first.
Homosexuality.
Homosexuality.
Tight pants. Muscly men.
Okay. The answer is homosexuality. And from Molly, what danger did Batman comics pose to the youth of America?
I think sort of the the coveting of riches, because Batman's a very rich man, a wealthy man, who's built sort of a bunch of toys and armor for him to wear.
Okay. So the choices are from Hank, homosexuality, from Molly, the wanting of money, greed, avarice, etc. Do we have any colloquy, as they say, any questions for the answerers?
I met Bruce Wayne once. I'm not saying he hit on me, but I'm saying most men who meet me hit on me.
I have a question for Hank.
I was... Will, you should ask it later, and just based on my experience, you should wait till we've been at sea a few more days. Just to have the chances of the answer you want. Just saying. But... All right, you actually have a question for him. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to... No, you're good. Okay. Does anybody else have any questions for either Molly or Hank?
Hank, in this study, were any other superheroes mentioned with the same threat?
I don't know that you call it a study.
It's this book.
Okay. Yes, Aquaman in particular. I don't know why. And the Green Lantern.
Right, obviously.
Well, men wearing jewelry.
Wow, really offended Green Lantern fans. All
right. Well, here are the choices.
Haven't you suffered enough?
Batman represented homosexuality to the children of America, and from Molly, it represented too much of a glorification of wealth. What are your choices, panelists? We have Hank. We have Robin shuffling with her papers again. We have Hank. There he goes. So four votes for Hank, which makes sense because Hank is right. Yeah! Really, Hank, you are right. We'll give you full 2 points for knowing the right answer. And also another 4 points because everybody believed you. You guys all get points. Everybody but Molly basically gets a point because you picked the right answer. And while you write all that down, Scarface, I will say that you, interestingly enough, Hank, were correct, but you missed the most important thing. The reason that Batman represented homosexuality was, of course, his weird relationship with Robin.
Yeah!
This is true. If you don't know this, I'm sure you're all comic book geeks, you should know about this. This book came out and showed that specifically crime comics, violent crime comics, and superhero comics, especially Batman, were creating juvenile delinquency. And that's why we have to this day a comics code. Mm-hmm. And that's what happened to the great EC horror comics and crime comics. They all went out of business. All right.
It certainly wasn't repressive parents that weren't involved in their children's upbringing.
No, it wasn't that. It wasn't that. All right. Second comic book question. Wonder Woman was created by a psychologist named William Moulton Marston. In addition to creating a strong female role model, he wanted to introduce what idea in a clever way to the American public, and I believe our answers now are Will. I'm sorry, if I do Will, that's not going to work. How do I do? I'll do Will and Ben. Will and Ben. And Will, you get to go first.
Greek mythology.
Greek mythology. You want to introduce Greek mythology to the American public, Ben?
Feminism.
Feminism. No, what I'm going to do is I'm going to. I mentioned that. So because I said a strong female role model, there was a feminist idea behind.
So I'm Wonder Woman,
but there was something else. No, I included that in the questions.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking for something else.
All right, bondage.
Bondage.
But not in that order.
But not in that order. All right. What order do you think he wanted to do it?
It was lateral.
It was lateral. So Ben's choice is bondage. Will's choice is Greek mythology. Do we have any questions for our answerers? No?
Bennett, please explain.
Well, Hank, when a man loves a woman very much.
It's a lasso thing. It's a Betty Page situation.
I'm sorry.
Ask your father-in-law.
Ask your father-in-law?
Keep it clean, guys. My father-in-law's in the audience. And so now I have to talk to...
Well, because you're asking me to explain in front of your father-in-law.
Oh, no, yeah, you know,
I didn't mean please explain the practice of bondage. It's been in relation to the question at hand.
Oh, all right, she's got a lasso.
Any other questions? Yes, Molly?
Ben, may I ask where the invisible boat, her invisible plane, I mean, figures into the whole?
Yeah, it's where she does this, the bondage.
Okay. That would be
a poor choice in terms of privacy.
The whole plane
does. I understand. All right. So the choices are from Ben, bondage, from Will, yes, Greek mythology. Please choose your answerer, Ben or Will. Somebody hum the Jeopardy theme. Scarface, can you hum the Jeopardy theme? Very good, very good. Are we ready? All right, reveal, please. We have Will, we have Will, we have Will, we have Will. You've chosen Greek mythology. It's bondage. William Moulton Marston was something of a sexual outlaw. He lived in a polygamous relationship with two other women, and he really liked the idea of very strong, dominant women in really high heels tying men up and making them do her will.
Yeah!
And he wanted to get those ideas out. Now, this is an interesting situation, because you, Ben, got 2 points for knowing the answer.
Bank.
Right? But Will, whose answer was a little dull, nonetheless gets 4 points because people were fooled by your... That doesn't seem right to me, but that's the game. So Will gets 4 points. Even though
it's like the 2000 election all over again.
All right, all right. This is fun. We're doing well. We're having a good time. Everybody doing great? Here we go. Your next category is Know Your Ocean. Being as we are in the ocean, some questions about the ocean. When Captain Cook, the British explorer, discovered Australia in the 1780s, I say discovered in quotes, I'm checking my privilege. His crew saw two naked Aborigines come to the shore, wave their spears and shout at them, but because the Aboriginal language is not related to Polynesian, they couldn't understand it, nor could their translators. What did it turn out were the natives shouting at Captain Cook and his ship? And I believe the answers in this case will be Robin and Graham.
Go away.
Go away. That's the answer from Robin. Go away, go away. From Graham?
Danger, actually.
Danger.
Danger.
They're trying to warn them of what?
Warn them of the shoreline.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the choices are from Robin, go away. From Graham,
Rocky
danger,
shoreline.
Warning them of the shoreline.
Danger, danger.
Once the language was translated and they understood what they were trying to say, all right. Any questions for our answerers?
Robin, I'm curious to know, after telling them to go away, where they went.
I hate you right now, Will.
The question wasn't what they did then. The question was what the Aborigines were saying. We don't know if they. The guys.
Thank you, Peter.
You're welcome.
Bondage.
And any questions for Graham before we choose? No? We're good? All right, we're going to make your choices. Everything. Scarface. Thank you. And we've made our choices, and these choices are, you're choosing, of course, from Robin and Grant. Grant, Grant, Robin and Grant. And I want to know if Robin knew this, because they were shouting, go away, go away. Did you know that, sir? You knew that?
I'm a genius.
Oh. So we have 3 choices for Grant, and we have 1 for Robin, but Robin also gets 2 points because she knew the answer. And by the way,
if I may, yeah. Can I give 1 of my points to Will, because I feel bad for saying a mean thing about him.
What? No, I don't think so.
Robin, I've really gotten used to people saying mean things about me. I'm really okay with
it. But I'm not. I'll take it. I'll take a point.
Yeah.
I'd like to give another point to Molly.
No. This is a good time, actually, because I think everybody has gone twice. Am I correct?
Yeah.
Everybody's gone twice. So what are the current scores, Scarface?
Right now, Ben has 4 points for wheat and bondage.
That's why I spent an afternoon.
It's high in calories, but enjoyable. Grant has 7 points for curling and danger. Molly, 1 point for eyelashes. Robin, 7 points for traffic lights go away. Will, 6 points for cane accidents and Greek myths. And Hank is winning with Indium and Gay Batman.
So Hank has how many points?
He has 10 points.
10 points, so Hank is leading.
All right. Would anyone like any of my points? Because you can't have them.
Okay.
Gay Batman.
So, Hank, you haven't been partnered with Graham, right?
That's correct.
Graham, I can call you Graham. I'm sorry, Grant.
Well, actually, we were in an elevator earlier together, alone. So you could say we've been partnered.
It's the law of the sea. I've noticed some subtext here. All right. Second question in the category Know Your Ocean. In April of last year, the United Nations welcomed to the Community of Nations a new island nation. I said nation three times. What is this new island nation? Hank?
I know this one, totally. I know this really well. This information is definitely inside of my brain.
We are waiting for you to let it out.
Island of...
Australia!
I'll just go with an island I've heard of. Let's go with Tuvalu.
Tuvalu! Tuvalu was welcomed into the United Nations.
Sure.
New island, Tuvalu.
That's a real island.
Wasn't there like a viral YouTube video of a Russian singer going Tuvalu, Valu, Valu? Grant.
That would be Tataranga, off the coast of Madagascar.
Whoa, you played that out there, man. Ooh, like you've been there. That was impressive. All right. You're going to have to say that again. Grant?
Tataranga.
Tataranga?
Tuvalu.
Tuvalu.
I know who I'd vote for.
Those are your choices.
Grant, do you know why an East African island would have a Polynesian-sounding name?
Thanks, Will.
I didn't choose the name, Will.
That just sounds racist.
The United Nations, why they allowed someone with a Polynesian. How do you know that's Polynesian, Will?
This is a sovereign. I am a cunning linguist.
This is a sovereign nation. They can choose whatever name they want.
Right. I'll point out that only one of us is sure that our island is actually an island.
Okay. So your choice then is Tuvalu, and your choice is Grant?
Tataranga.
Thank you. Please choose your answer. Answerer. Have we chosen? Robin, you seem to be having a lot of difficulty with this paper thing.
No, it's not the paper, it's decision making.
Oh, I understand. Okay, ready? And reveal, please. Hank, Grant. Hank, three for Hank, one for Grant. He did sound confident, didn't he? He's like, I know this. He is wrong, but you did sound confident. The answer is, Tuvalu has been a nation for a while. The nation that was welcomed into the United Nations by UNESCO especially is called Garbage Patch. What happened was UNESCO decided to bring attention to the giant floating piles of garbage that are in our oceans. This is getting very sad quickly. By creating a new nation called Garbage Patch.
Are we going to hit one in the boat while we're here?
Yes.
Patch of garbage?
Molly Adorable only goes so far.
I think that'd be great.
So,
which one of the Garbage Pail Kids is their ambassador?
So, that was 3 points for Hank and one for Grant. Am I right? Okay.
Yes.
As I'm winning, stop giving me points.
All right. Our next category is Sportsball. Sportsball. Clarence Bleffen. I'm sure you all remember Clarence Bleffen. He played in 1923 for the Boston Red Sox. And he reached base once in his big year career. That was exciting. However, he had to be removed from the game almost immediately afterwards. Why? I'm sorry, I wrote this in. He had injured himself. How did he injure himself? Clarence Bleffen, 1923, Boston Red Sox. And I believe at this time, let me think, we're starting, I think we should start again at the beginning to make the matchup, so we'll go with Hank and Ben again, except this time Bank. Is that right?
No.
Well, we've done all, we've done, you just went.
Will and Molly.
All right, hold on. Oh, sorry, Will and Molly? Will and Molly, Will and Molly? I'm sure one of you sons of bitches has already have an app for it. Will and Molly. Will and Molly, and we'll let Molly go first. How did Clarence Bleffen injure himself right after getting to base the first time?
He did a little victory dance and he sprained something.
He did a little victory dance and sprained something. Will.
This game was played against the New York Yankees.
Yes.
And a New York, I know, I hate them. And a New York Yankees fan actually threw... I believe it was a Red Hot at him.
A Red Hot?
Yes.
Now, do you mean like the candy or like
no,
a hot
I mean
dog?
Like the hot dog.
Like the hot dog.
The hot, spicy hot dog.
Yeah.
And the Red Hot, whatever it is that makes them red hot, got into his eyes and he had to be taken out of the game because he couldn't see.
Okay. So Will's answer is he was blinded by a Red Hot, a thrown Red Hot from the stands. Molly's answer, he injured himself in a victory celebration. He finally made it to first base in a big league game, injured himself. Those are your choices. Do we have any questions?
Wait, Will, so you are saying a fan threw a hot dog from the stands and hit the player in the face.
That's exactly what I'm saying. That's actually not what I'm saying. That's what Ken Burns said.
What?
It is an infamous incident in baseball history.
Okay.
Bust this moment.
Is your answer he was injured by a Red Hot or that a Red Hot was thrown at him, because that changes how I feel.
A Red Hot was thrown at him from the...
Just say that he was injured by a Red Hot, because I'm pretty sure it's just that he had it when he was in the dugout and then he was having digestive problems.
Listen, I would love it if he had to be removed from the game so he didn't shit himself on his way to second base. That's not what happened. He was hit in the face with, you can call it a hot dog if you want it. He was hit in the face with a meaty byproduct. Mostly hooves and anuses. And they had to take it because they tried to wipe it out and it actually got into his eye. And he had to come
That's out very convincing. All right, are we ready to choose?
That's why Yankees fans suck.
All right. Robin and Will, please make your selections here. And Molly. I'm sorry, Molly. I'm sorry, I said Robin.
Molly.
Will, you can't choose Grant. Molly and Molly. So Molly gets three votes, right? And Will gets one. This is interesting. Molly is right in that has happened. Players have injured themselves celebrating getting on base or more often making a home run. There's one guy who jumped up, landed on home plate after hitting a game-winning home run, promptly broke his leg and lost the rest of the season. But that's not what happened to Clarence Bleffen. What Clarence Bleffen did was he bit himself in the ass. One of the most famous and infamous injuries in all of Major League Baseball, Clarence Bleffen had dentures. It was his habit when running the bases to take the dentures out, put them in his rear pocket, and he stole second base. And he was so excited and threw himself in so hard that the dentures bit him in the ass so badly, he had to come out of the game. So 3 points for Molly. So it's a great cover. 1 point. Will. I like the details of your story.
Will, that was amazing.
That was very good. You deserve
you
more than that.
You should be very proud of yourself.
You deserve more points.
As a side note, we are never playing Mafia together. Oh. Never.
Now, the next category is Know Your Cruisers. Know Your Cruisers. This is a question about one of our shipmates. It happens to be, in fact, Nathan Sawaya's wife, Courtney Simmons. She's here with us. And she has a job that at first she wanted no one on this cruise to know. This is true. We talked about this at the opening cocktail party Saturday night. She was afraid of how you sea monkeys would react and then treat her. Okay? So I have gotten her permission to do this. I'm going to ask you guys, what is her job? And my players this time should be, I'm guessing, Robin and Ben. Right? Robin and Ben. So Robin, you first. What is sea monkey Courtney Simmons, wife of Nathan Sawaya, what is her job?
She's an ice sculptor.
She's an ice sculptor. That would go nicely with her husband who makes Lego sculpture. Okay. Why would people react negatively or in any way provocatively to an ice sculptor?
Well, I'm just going on my own feelings.
Okay. Hostility toward ice sculptures?
Hostility is a big word.
Yeah. Rage?
Like ambient disgust.
All right. Ambient disgust. All right. That's your choice. Ben, what is your job?
Well, it has to do with gay Batman.
And what?
Bondage Wonder Woman.
Bondage, gay bapping and Bondage Wonder Woman.
She works for DC Comics.
She works for DC Comics. And presumably she would not want people to know this. Why?
They shit the bed recently with the launch of a new 52.
Yeah.
I think they call it. And people here care about that, sorry.
The new 52 dead enders are in this room. They're not going to sell a single new 52 this week because both of you guys are in this room.
So here are your choices. From Robin, that she's an ice sculptress. From Ben, that she works for DC Comics and is afraid of your rage. Which is the right answer? Ben or Robin? And has everybody chosen? All right. All right. Everybody reveal, please. Ben. Everybody voted for Ben. Ben is right. And I remember now, this is grossly unfair, that we were talking about it in the first day.
Pre-show.
You were there.
Pre-show.
It's terrible. I forgot. I actually forgot that he knew. But nonetheless, he did know. It is true, Courtney, a lovely person, is in fact a senior vice president at DC Entertainment, which publishes DC Comics, Vertigo Comics, and Mad Magazine. And she was in fact afraid that you would corner her and tell her why the new 52 sucked, or your idea for a new Batman comic. But now she's been with you for a few days and she says, bring it on, motherfuckers. Words to that effect. She actually said, maybe I should do office hours, which is brave. So there you are. All right. We only have a few more minutes, so we're going to go to the last couple of questions. This category is other interesting subcultures beside yourselves, you solipsistic bastards. And we will turn to the world of sex. In fact, the swingers community. Right? You know what the swingers are. They meet up. They swing. There is a term in that community which is unicorn. And I'm going to ask, I believe it is Grant's turn on my right, and whose turn on my left? Actually, you know what? We should... Unicorn. Actually, it occurs to me we should have two people on the same side, right? So why don't we have... well, it doesn't matter. We'll have Grant... I think it would be fun to have Hank do this, please. Grant and Hank. In the swinging community, what is a unicorn? You know.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. That is a creepy room. Can I say that? Never mind. Go ahead. So Grant, your answer is, in the swinging community, a unicorn is what?
Yes. A unicorn is a person who wears a dildo on their forehead. For the purpose of participating in these.
That's a unicorn. That makes sense visually.
That's a common misconception.
Of course.
That is actually referred to as a rhino.
That's how big the unicorn is.
Important question. Are there triceratops in this community?
That's a subculture, mommy. Okay. That's a Reddit. That's a subreddit. Okay.
Much less interestingly, a unicorn is simply a single male.
A single male.
Yeah. So in the swingers community, there's sort of, and they, so they call that, oh, a unicorn showed up.
Okay. So a single male. And Rob has a question.
So if you're a single person, male or otherwise, how are you swinging?
Right. It's a derogatory term.
They're like, oh god, why are you here? Freaking unicorns.
Right.
Because they only bring one horn to the party.
All right, your choices are from Hank, a single male, comes to the party, nobody wants him there. From Grant, the person who likes to... Suction cup action. So Will, Robin, Molly, and Ben, make your choice, please. You're choosing between Hank and Grant. Grant, because we love that image. Grant and Hank. Interesting. I feel I should say that what I'm about to tell you comes not from my personal experience. Not that there's anything wrong with that. But from a book I wrote a while ago called The Book of Vice, which I researched this. Hank, you are correct in that single men are unwanted. But their solution to that is not to give them a name and hope they'll feel unwanted and leave, but simply not to let them in. Your idea is genius, and I'm going to call up some friends of mine and tell them neither are correct.
Oh, thank God I was wrong.
A unicorn is a sane, disease-free, bisexual woman who will agree to have a no-strings-attached threesome with you and your spouse and then go away and never bother you again. And the reason they are called unicorns is because they do not exist. This is interesting. I have more questions than we're able to use. But who are our last two answerers? So people help me out. So we have just said you guys went. So let's say you've all gone with each other. Let's bring it down to the two ladies, ladies' privilege. And I will ask you to choose between two categories. I have either the arts or what normal people like, or category a supposedly fun thing we do every year, or cruising, cruise ships.
Molly,
why
did you pick it? I leave that to you.
You want to do the cruising one to
sort of bring it to, around full circle
to pander?
Sure.
Yeah. All right.
People pleasing.
All right, so we're going to go with cruising. This last cruising question, and appropriately enough, it's about a cruise ship. It's about the Costa Concordia. We all know that ship. Tragically, that's funny. People die, friend. The Costa Concordia, as you know, is the Italian cruise ship that went aground off Italy after passing too close to a picturesque harbor town. Authorities believe that the captain of the ship sailed too close to the shore because he wanted to do what? Robin.
Take a picture.
Take a picture. He was like, no, closer, please. My Italian accent. Molly.
I believe he had a mistress on land that he was going to sort of, what's the word, tender towards. I mean, multiple meanings.
He wanted to pick up?
To pick up a chick.
To pick up a chick. Right, okay. So the answers are from Robin, he wanted to take a picture of his picturesque Italian village.
Take a picture.
From Molly, he wanted to pick up a chick.
I feel like a zoom lens would have been a lot cheaper.
It's a good answer on a lot of levels.
All right.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Any questions for this is our final question.
Molly, this was the needs of the one outweighing the needs of the many.
Yeah. Did you see, they have recordings of his dispatches with the Coast Guard. They're saying, you need to get back on the ship, you are the captain. And he's like, no, I'm just helping women and babies. It's fine. This captain was much about the needs of the one, it sounds like.
Okay, any more questions? And the final choices, we have Molly and Robin. Who's it going to be? Molly? Molly? Robin? And Molly. Three choices for Molly. All right. Molly was close. Among the reasons in general, he was being dumb, but they believe that one of the reasons he wanted to go so close to the shore and put his ship into danger was to impress his 26-year-old Moldavian dancer girlfriend named Domnica Xamortan, who wasn't even supposed to be on the boat. He was like, here, let me show you this. So who thinks Molly should get that point anyway? Molly gets 2 points for knowing the right answer. Who picked Molly? Three people picked Molly and one person picked Robin. So get a point and we will give Scarface a second to calculate our final scores. Here we go. Is everybody nervous? Because I don't know who won. I asked Jonathan Colton, you've heard of him. What I wanted was I want Nathan Sway to make a full-size Lego model of the winner, but I'm told that's impractical. I mean, although he has, what, he's 100,000 Lego pieces? Come on, Nathan, what else are you doing in the cruise? You're done with your show.
And steal the right. Lego model.
Drew, what do you think?
All right, you want to hear them starting with last place?
Please.
Okay. Will, you're in last place. We have a tie for fourth between Robin and Molly. Both with 8 points. Will, you had 6 points. In third place, Ben.
I would like to bank again.
With Wheat, Bondage, DC Comics. Good work. Second place, Grant. Curling, Danger, Tataranga, Forehead, Dildo. 11 points. First place, Hank.
Congratulations to Hank being the winner of the first ever This American Life floating quiz show. Listen, before I finish, before I let these guys go, first of all, thank to our wonderful panelists. Give them a round. I really want to thank Mike Selinker, a game designer and quiz designer, and Drew Curtis from FARC, both on the ship, who gave up karaoke last night to help me put this together. Thank you guys, I could not have done it without you. And for me, a real personal thank you to Mr. JoCo, Paul, and Storm for having me back again. It's great to be home. Thank you guys.
That's Peter Sagal from This American Life, everybody. All the panelists, thank you so much, guys. That was hilarious. Everybody, very quickly, put on your tuxedos. We'll see you at dinner.